Hey friends, welcome back. This is week two on our study of creativity. Creativity is imagining the things you could do because you were created in the image of God. Last week we learned about the days of creation, all the things that God fit in that 6 days. And in the end, he had one very special creation that played out on your birthday. You see, you are God's very special creation. He created you with a plan and a purpose, and we're going to hear a little bit more about that today. Before we turn it over to Pastor David, let me remind you to hit like so that we know you're here, and then hit share so that your friends can see this as well. Now, if you would, take a moment to bow your heads and close your eyes, and let's ask God to help us listen well to the truth we're about to hear. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you that we're not accidents. Thank you that you created each and every one of us with our own DNA, our own fingerprints, and our own plan. You specifically have a plan for each and every one of us in our lives. Now, as we see your creativity play out through your plan in our lives, and we hear the message that Pastor David's getting ready to bring us, we ask that you open our ears, our hearts, and our minds to the truth that we'll hear today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, good morning. I just want to welcome you guys back here with us. And I just am so excited about the fact that as we begin to start this month of August, being in week two, we have the opportunity to talk about the fact that there is a place in God's creation for you. I remember when I was young, man. I mean, I'm telling you, when I was probably 12 or 13 years old, this guy named Michael W. Smith used to sing a song called Place in This World. He said, there's a place in this world looking for a reason, roaming through the night to find my place in this world. And you know, the thing is that a lot of times people spend a lot of time looking for their place. They really don't know where they fit. Sometimes they feel like they're a square peg in a round hole. Sometimes they feel like that they're out of place, that they don't fit in. I mean, when you come into a lunchroom and there's one person, one place left at the table in the cafeteria, sometimes it feels awkward to take that spot. Sometimes when you're getting ready to pick teams, it feels awkward when you're near the end of the pick. I mean, that's just the way it is. We don't feel like we have a place. So today I'm going to talk to you out of the book of Ephesians. So I want you to get your Bibles today, and we're going to talk in the book of Ephesians. So remember, there's the Old Testament that's in the front. There's the New Testament that's in the back. And we're going to be in the book of Ephesians. Now, one of the things about the book of Ephesians is it's part of those Paul epistles that are Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians. And you guys know, I remember, because God eats potato chips. And Galatians, Ephesians, the second of those. So, turn in your Bible to Ephesians chapter 2. We're going to be in verse 10 today. So, I want to just start out by saying that there are so many creative people in this world. I was just talking to my friend Ricky just today, and we were saying, hey, how did you know when you were creative? And he said, you know something? I just started out that way. I just started making things. He told great stories about doing things that were creative and how when he was a kid, he used to use his G.I. Joe and Star Wars characters and do creative things in the front yard. But here's the deal. Here's the deal. God made us to be creative. I don't know if you are like this, but I feel like there's people that are like super creative, and I kind of try to put them in a box, and then there's people that are just like not creative, and we're all the ones on the outside of the fence. I don't know how you see it, but I see people that do amazing things. I mean, I'm a Kansas City Chiefs fan. I think that Patrick Mahomes is an amazingly creative quarterback, and I see him, and I think, oh, he's over here in this box. He's this, and then I see people, and I throw the football out on the football field, and I feel like it doesn't even go very far, and I'm like, dude, I'm not even close to that, you know? And then there's people that do music. I mean, there are people that sell gold, platinum albums, and they, because they sell so many songs. I jump on Spotify, and I listen to my daily mix, and they'll send new people to me to listen to that go along with what I like, and I'm telling you, I'm like, wow, that's really cool. I listen to a group called Johnny Swim. I think they're amazing. I listen to a group called Need to Breathe. And I'm telling you, I listen to Need to Breathe. That's an amazing group. Some of my favorite music is in that kind of thing. And then I think that there's artists. I think about these guys that did these incredible paintings. They painted like Sistine Chapel has been painted, and then they paint the Dutch masters, and there's cubism and all of these different art forms, and these guys do these incredible paintings, and I think, wow, that's them. They're over there. They're creative. There's a spot for them. But I think about myself, and I'm like, you know, I'm not really creative at that. But you know something? The fact of the matter is, I have a creative streak. I love to make things and to fix things. Just the other night, our card shuffler for playing games, it broke. I took it apart. I glued the part that broke back together. I made it work again because I am creative. And it's exciting to me to be able to be creative, and there's a place for all of us. So here we are. We have to find out about these other people. Do they consider themselves to be in a box and not able to be touched by anything else? And that's what goes on. So as these celebrities, there's like they're there, and then the non-creative people are over here. And we have to say, well, how do we deal with that? Is there a spot for me? Is there a place for me on the team? And the answer to that is yes, because you are wildly creative in some way. I don't know whether it's music. I don't know whether it's art. I don't know whether it's playing sports. I don't know whether it's dance. Maybe you can cook like crazy. I love to cook. Maybe you know, you're a gardener. Maybe you're a person that is just totally amazingly able to make some of the coolest forts of anybody. Because you know that's a talent there, being able to make a cool fort. Or, you know, maybe you're a bike riding stunt artist, or maybe you're a skateboarder. I don't know if soccer is your thing. Maybe you can score a goal like no one else, but there are places that you're creative, and we are all going to be able to find the niche, the thing that God's made for us to be creative in. And that's what our lesson is about today, because there was a man whose name was Paul. And if you can remember part of our studies that we've done over the last few months, we know that Paul had this experience with Jesus. There was a time when Paul was named Saul, and he was traveling from one place to another, and he was going there to persecute Christians. And God was not pleased with that. And so God meets him on the road in a bright light, and he falls off his horse, and he looks and says, "Lord, what are you doing? And who are you?" And God says, "I'm Jesus, the one who you persecute." And at that time, Saul becomes Paul. He's converted. Now, we also know that he has more to his story. He goes on and he starts telling the gospel of Jesus Christ to other people who don't trust him. And they have to learn to get along with him after they didn't like him. And that even gets even different because then he gets arrested by the Roman government. He gets sent off to Rome in chains. And on the way, he has shipwrecks. He gets bitten by snakes. There's a lot of things that happen on his road. But what is amazing is that on this encounter, he ends up in the town of Ephesus. And in that town of Ephesus, Paul starts a church. And while he's there in that church, Paul begins to write letters that are relevant to our discussions today. And that letter is the book of Ephesians, chapter 2, verse 10. Go to it in your Bible now. Here it is. "For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works." Now, that's our whole verse for today, that we are God's workmanship and we are created by Him. Pay attention to this next little commercial that I have for you.
Hey parents, I want to take just a little bit of time in the middle of the video here to talk to you about family discipleship. You see, family discipleship is what we're finding is being the most effective right now with us not being able to be in services as much, not being able to gather together as a church, and we just want to support you as the parent. I want to encourage you with these words out of Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 9. The Bible says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. These commands I give you today to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them When you sit at home, when you walk along the road, when you lie down, and when you get up. See, what we're supposed to do as parents is really remind our kids about God, family, discipleship throughout our whole day. And we want to encourage you to take the steps necessary to see your kids grow spiritually, to see their spiritual journey extended. So, in these times, we want to support you through our online stuff like you're watching today. We also have stuff on our Family Matters page, as well as great links in our Right Now media. Make sure you take advantage of these, and if there's any way we can help you, please let us know.
Hey guys, welcome back. I really want to encourage you to like and to share the videos that we're doing so that more people can hear the gospel of Jesus Christ and to know what we're doing here at Northside, Northside Kids. I want to remind you that we've just gotten done reading our verse, and I want to read it to you again. It's Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. It says this, "For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works." You see, that's what God created us for. Our masterpiece fit in God's creation is that we were created to do God's work. Every single one of us is a masterpiece created by God for an individual purpose. Because in the big scheme of things, we all have a place to play. We all have a part to fulfill. We all have a script that we're supposed to find and a script that we're supposed to do. Just like today, when we're standing here and we're hearing the gospel and we're hearing the good news, we can invite our friends, we can do these things, but we are created for a purpose and a time to accomplish God's best. Well, Paul wrote that what we really need to do to show that we love God is to love others in a unique way. We're supposed to love others like God loves us. That comes on in the book of Ephesians, verse 4. It says to be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven us. That's exactly what he's called us to do. It's in a unique way. We are given love to give to others. So we are God's creation, and God has given us a place. So what we're supposed to do is be doing good works for God. Not because we have to, but because we want to. Not because God makes us, but because God allows us. There's a big difference between being made to do something and being allowed to be creative and do things. I wanted to tell you that there's been some things that I've seen kids do that have just been phenomenal. And I've got a couple of things I want to tell you about. Number one, we began to talk about fortune cookies. How many of you have ever been out to eat at an Asian restaurant? When you go out to an Asian restaurant, you will eat there, and they give you a fortune cookie at the end, and you open it up, and it says, oh, do something great, or it says, make sure that you keep your inner child, and on the back, it's got a couple of numbers. But what I'm thinking about is that this person said, you know what we need to do? We need to make godly fortune cookies. So when you open the fortune cookie, it says, God loves you, God wants to be your friend. Can you imagine how cool that would be? That would be an idea that would take off in a great way. One of my other friends, she took her wiki sticks at school and she took the wiki sticks and made them in the form of a cross. And she got so excited about it that she began to sell those wiki sticks in groups, and she took that money and gave it to missions as a way to make money for missions in her school project. Now, let me think about this. The first thing is she was doing something great. The second thing is it got to be seen at her school so other people could see what she was doing about selling the wiki sticks for her class project. Can you imagine the conversations? Why did you make a cross? Why did you decide to do that? All of those conversations pointed to the opportunity for Lily to share what God had done in her life and how much Jesus meant to her. Now, we have all been uniquely made. Maybe you are not a person that's creative when it comes to putting your wiki sticks together. And I mean, I wasn't. I used them for bookmarks and I kind of played with them and got them dirty and they didn't work anymore. That's what I did with them. I never thought about using them to tell the gospel. I mean, I never thought about taking a fortune cookie and cracking it open and finding there'd be a Bible verse. Those kind of things didn't come natural for me. What came natural for me is writing. I wrote a story in the seventh grade, and the story was about Jesus being my best friend. It wasn't until a bunch of years later I ran into a girl whose name is Penny, and she said, when I was in seventh grade, I remember the story that you read to the class. I just used the creativity that God gave me in order to share Him with others. So for some people, creativity works by playing the piano. For some people, it works by drawing. For some people, it works in the ability they have with computers. For some people, it's sports. But whatever it is for you, you find it, you do it, you be creative, you show that God has something for you to do. For others, it could look totally different, like solving complicated puzzles. It could be for people who be able to find errors in writing. It could be for people who are able to write in the first place, which I am just not good at all. But you see that everybody's got something to do. We've all got a part to play. What are things that you like to do and they come natural for you? I kind of feel like God would not tell you to do something that you really didn't feel like you were talented in. Well, if God gave you talent like art, then use it to be the Bob Ross of the Christian faith. I mean, we need a happy painter out there. If you're the one that's just the singer, we need more Michael W. Smiths. I mean, we need people who will stand up and will take the talent that God has given them and the creativity that God has given them and use it for His glory to do good works. Because God has prepared for you to do good works. And I want you to ask God how you find what it is He's got for you. And I'm going to give you some hints. Number one, you need to talk to your parents because they're going to train you in the way you should go. You should ask your teachers, hey, what do you think I'm good at? You should ask your friends. But you know what? Sometimes your friends aren't the best option. I'm just going to be honest with you. Because making those sounds under your arm is really not a talent. All right? Lastly, I'd like to say, how are you creative? Are you creative in some way that's different than others? Use that for God. Man, that's so exciting to be able to use your talent. Right now, think about that talent. Maybe you could write it down. Maybe you could start thinking about opportunities you have to use that talent for Jesus. And guys, we're always wanting to hear from you and what you have to say about what you've heard today. So please write us. We'd love to hear from you. I want to pray with you, and then we'll be done. Well, Lord and Heavenly Father, I am so glad that you've given us creativity. I am so glad that you've given us the opportunity to do things that are amazing. And while, Lord, we might not be the next platinum artist, I'm convinced that we can sure make the praise team sound good. And Lord, while we might not be the next Michelangelo, I'm sure that we can decorate our house to look really cool to have friends over. Lord, I pray that you will show us what you have for us and help us to do the good works that you've called us to do. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Well, thanks so much for being with us, guys. I look forward to seeing you next week.
So have you thought about the unique ways that you are created? You know, we all have our own gifts and talents and abilities, and God gave those to us so that we can serve Him. So how has God created you to be creative? Remember our memory verse is Psalms 145 verse 3. Lord, you are great. You are really worthy of our praise, and no one can understand how truly great you are. That's Psalms 145 verse 3. There's no limit to God's creativity, and God created you so that you can be creative. Have a great week. We'll see you next time.